We will discuss today the retroperitoneoscopic approach, how to go there. This is basically for the urologist, but the general surgeons for doing some of the lumbar sympathectomy, and gynecologist for the cervical lymph node dissection, they approach this procedure. Pediatric surgeon also, they have to do sometime the retroperitoneoscopy. Retroperitoneoscopy was first performed by Bartel in 1969. And he was reported first to do the endoscopic visualization of the pelvic retroperitoneum. In 1974, Witt Mosers has performed the first endoscopic lumbar sympathectomy. The technique was called at that time lumboscopy. And in summer camp in 1974, has performed the first retroperitoneoscopic renal biopsy. Retroperitoneoscopic laparoscopic using a laparoscope was first performed in 1979 by Wickman, and he has performed the uretrolithotomy. This is the anatomy of the kidney, which we know that this is the left side of the kidney. Here is the suprarenal. This is the splenic flexor. And here will be the spleen. This is the pancreas, tail of the pancreas, and this is colon. This is splenic flexor of the colon. Now the right side, again this is suprarenal, this is liver, this is second part of the duodenum, and this is hepatic flexor of the colon. This is the anterior relation of the kidney. Posteriorly there are two important muscles. One is psoas and another is quadratus lumborum. These two muscles give the bed for the kidney to rest upon. Whenever you enter by retroperitoneoscopic approach, then first thing what you have to find out is the ureter. And ureter always lies over the psoas muscle. Medially it will be found. And just after this ureter, you will have the peritoneum there. This peritoneum will differentiate, and it will be the boundary between the retroperitoneum and the intra-abdominal organs. Whenever you are going through the retroperitoneum, you have to take care that accidentally peritoneum should not be breached. The vena cava and aorta is also different relation for the both the side of the kidney. Like for the left side, aorta is nearer, vena cava is away, and for the right side, vena cava is nearer and aorta is away. As far as surgery is concerned, many of the surgeons, they consider the left nephrectomy easier than the right one. And this way, same true is true for the laparoscopic approach also. This is the relation of the arteries, and you can have the different like the left renal pelvis, then the inferior adrenal artery, and this way all the branches are the same, like left upper polar artery, then the left inferior adrenal artery, adrenal arteries, and then left renal veins. So this way different relations are there for both the sides. Now patient position. Position of the patient for any retroperitoneoscopic approach, that you have to approach the patient from behind. You have to approach the patient from behind. And you should put the patient in the flank position. And operation table should be widened so that patient should be in the kidney bridge position. This is the position of the patient. And once you have it, then you can start the retroperitoneoscopy at the point of the access. Surgeon stands behind the patient. If you are doing retroperitoneoscopy, and surgeon stands in front of the patient if you are performing transabdominal nephrectomy. No preformed spacer are there. There are a lot of difficulty in the access. One of the big difficulty is, like abdominal cavity, we don't have the preformed space. And you cannot use the varus needle. Just by the varus needle, you cannot put the gas there. And you have to break the tough fibrous trabeculae. And you have to separate the garrotage fascia from the peritoneum. So this dense areolar fibrofatty tissue has to be separated by the finger dissection. So these are some of the difficulty in the access of the retroperitoneum. Now, where should be the port? the first port, that is the optical port, should be in between the over the posterior axillary line, in between the 12th rib and anterior superior iliac spine. This is the first port position, which has to be kept in mind. And this is the optical port. When you are performing the procedure, then you should landmark this point. Here we can see these are the costal margins. And this is iliac crest. So highest point of the iliac crest and in between the costal margin along the line of the posterior axillary line is your optical port. Optical port should be introduced at this point and it should be ideally 12 mm. Why? Because 10 mm would not be effective. Because you have to introduce your complete finger to do the finger dilatation. And once you will introduce the finger in the 10 mm, it will get little dilated. And 12, sometime up to 15 mm port is required. Even in the pediatric case also, 10 mm is required because kidney will not come out if your port is 5 mm. So this is the point of the access here. Patient will be in the kidney bridge position. There should be the elevation of the kidney bridge at this point. Like this, your patient has the kidney bridge position. Sudden stand on the back of the patient. And then you will start your performing the procedure. And the first port should be in between the iliac crest and the costal margin and posterior axillary line. Once you have defined the place of introduction of your trocar, then this is the point. This is the posterior axillary line. This is the 12th rib and this is iliac crest and this is the point. This is the point. This is the posterior axillary line. And this is the first port. Even in the pediatric, these are the pediatric age group. Even in the pediatric age group, you should put the 10 to 12 mm port for retroperitoneoscopy. Because ultimately, for nephrectomy, you have to take the kidney out from that wound. This is the point here, posterior axillary line and in between the iliac crest and the costal margin. And here should be 12 to 15 mm. After that, you give one small incision initially and then you take one blunt artery forceps straight. And after cutting the skin and fascia, then bluntly you have to puncture the thoracolumbar fascia. Once you will puncture the thoracolumbar fascia, you will see it there, that it is going. And you will feel the giving away sensation. So we can see here that once you will pierce it, this is the giving away sensation. If you see again very carefully, that it will give you a thrust and immediately it will enter like that. So what is this giving way? That you have pierced the thoracolumbar fascia. And just after entering into the thoracolumbar fascia, you have the retroperitoneal space. And after that, you can open it, and then you should check the finger, and you should try to do the finger dilatation. So this is the finger. And now you have to make a space. When you are using your finger, you should try to separate the peritoneum from the Garrotta's fascia by the manipulation of the finger. When you are putting the finger there, remember that accidentally finger should not rupture the peritoneum. You should be towards the soft muscle and then try to break the fibroareolar trabeculis. You have to break the trabeculis. Don't try to injure the peritoneum. And this is a small pocket which is necessary to make in order to put your balloon dilator. And just like the retroperitoneal hernia, that is transabdominal hernia surgery, totally extrapeitoneal hernia surgery, totally extrapeitoneal birth suspension. Same way, the finger manipulation is the important step in order to have the sufficient space to put your balloon dilator. Now, this is the balloon cannula system. And you should introduce this balloon cannula system inside and then you inflate it. What is balloon cannula system? This is balloon cannula system. you can have the gloves of the finger, and you can tie this gloves of the finger along the sleeve of the cannula, the sleeve which you have seen, it is threaded, and then introduce into the cannula. And after that, this is the balloon cannula system sleeve. You will introduce into the wound. This is the iliac crest, this is the costal margin, and this is over the posterior axillary line, you have the wound. And directly cannula will enter. And then inflate it. Once you will inflate with the balloon, you should give the 100 millimeter of the water, that is the pressure, so that at least 200 ml of the fluid should accommodate. Although in the gloves balloon, sometimes it is difficult to accommodate 200 ml, but the idea is that there should be sufficient dilatation. And then keep that balloon inflated for at least 5 minutes, so that the lateral pressure will achieve hemostasis there. You have the sufficient hemostasis, then deflate the fluid and take the balloon cannula system out. Now this is the balloon cannula system coming out. So this way your potential space is created. Once your potential space is sufficiently now in the position, after that you will start your procedure, and just you fix the cannula directly. You may have to apply one or two purse string sutures in order to have the prevent the leakage of the gas, and then you connect the cannula with the insufflator and insufflate the retroperitoneal space with 19 to 22 also you can give. Here some high pressure is required. Remember that in the transabdominal approach, like laparoscopic procedure, we cannot give the pressure more than 12 to 15, but in the retroperitoneum you are allowed to go up to 22, because you are not pressing the diaphragm, you are not pressing the vena cava directly. There is less chance of the hypercarbia, because the CO2 is not exposed to the complete peritoneal membrane. So in those situations, you need little more pressure. One of the another drawback is that you have to stabilize the cannula nicely. For that, you should put the cannula and then you take one stitch over the skin and fix that stitch with the inlet of the air of the cannula. If you see very carefully, there is one thread here, isn't it? The purpose of this stitch is that it will not allow the cannula to come out. And then take one adhesive tape and just wrap it around the distal end of the cannula. And purpose of this adhesive tape is it will not allow this to go in. So this way it is completely stabilized. This can be done in any of the procedure where your patient is of a small size and very thin, and you have a repeated problem of coming the cannula out or in. In those situations, this is a technique of stabilizing the cannula. And that way it won't go further in, it will not come out also. Yes, in those situations you can try this. You can have a tie and fix it with the air inlet and then apply one strapping there. It will not go. This strapping is not for, and it is not necessary that it should be adhered there. Even it is not adhered in the skin due to the hair of the animal or due to the hair of any patient also, then also it will work. Why? The purpose of this strapping is not to allow to go in, isn't it? And if it is a mass there, your cannula will not go further in. And to prevent it coming out, this knot and stitch will work through the skin. Just by the side of the wound, only one edge of the skin, the same wound, you take a bite and tie it there. And after that, you can work very comfortably and it won't come in and out. After that, you can just start. Now we will see some of the important videos of the laparoscopic procedure, like retroperitoneoscopic nephrectomy. Once you go in, then the first thing what you will see is the psoas muscle. This is the psoas muscle, and these are the trabeculis, fibrous trabeculis. And you should break all those with the help. The gynecologists generally for the cervical cancer, they enter in this space for the lymph node dissection. and you might have some of the retroperitoneoscopic lymph node, which may be little more risky if you will go through the transabdominal. You can take it from here. Urologist can go for nephrourethrolithotomy, and you can go even for the nephrectomy also. Once you will break those trabeculae, then first thing what you will get is the ureter. And once you catch the ureter, after that you will use the ureter as a retractor, and you can mobilize the kidney from behind. So this way you will hold the ureter and break all those posterior aspects of, this is the kidney, this is ureter, and you will break these trabeculae to mobilize the dorsal aspect of the kidney completely. In this way, this is kidney now, and it is getting mobilized all around. And once it is mobilized here, then it will automatically, the gas will help you to create the space. Due to the gas, you have a sufficient space there, and complete kidney all around can be mobilized.